Well, whatever the hell this is, it's starting.
Hey, kids! You're listening to a couple of annoyed grunt boys, and this is the 138th Simpsons Podcast. That's right, we're the Simpsons Podcast that discusses the beloved animated sitcom The Simpsons from seasons 11 and beyond, and the new episodes when they air. Why do we do it this way? Well, you see, there's plenty of other podcasts out there that have discussed the Golden Age, that being seasons 1 through 10, so we were tasked to find if there's episodes that can match those rival seasons. And when I say we, I don't do this alone. I'm just one annoyed grunt boy named Craig. With me, as always, is the other annoyed grunt boy...
Steve! Hey, Craig!
Oh, hello, Steve. It's been a couple of weeks. You've always had some fun stories. I can't imagine you have another fun story for us.
I do have one. Once again, I manage a coffee, beer, and wine bar instead of an international grocery store. And we have a policy where you have to buy something to use the restroom. It's common practice, especially now, because there is a fentanyl crisis going through America. So people like to do drugs in the bathrooms. And we don't want that because it makes it less pleasant for our paying customers. So a guy comes in and he wants to use the bathroom. We say, no, you got to buy something. So he walks out of the door and walks down the street about 20 feet from our store and proceeds to defecate in the middle of the street. And if that weren't disgusting enough, he has the audacity to come back in the store and ask for hand sanitizer.
Well, that's like a big F you, right?
it really is. It's like, hey, I got shitty hands. Can I use your hand sanitizer?
Wait.
I'm not going to buy anything.
What's he need the hand sanitizer for?
I don't know. I mean, I don't know if he wiped or not, and I don't want to get too graphic, but he was wanting hand sanitizer after dropping a deuce, so...
And, you know, people are wondering, why are so many businesses leaving downtown Portland? Why are people moving out, you know?
Yeah, it's rough out there. Like, it's not dangerous. It's just annoying.
We have cops that don't want to do their jobs.
Mm-hmm.
We have a mayor that no one likes.
Who does nothing.
And all I'm saying is, just give everyone a drink.
Drink.
Stop shitting in the street.
Yeah.
You know, give people alcohol. They won't do something stupid like that.
Oh, no, that's totally fine.
After that story, Steve, I do need a drink, if that's okay with you.
I think that sounds like a great idea.
Should we go to a Simpsons Beer Corner?
I think so.
Well, I'm sorry to hear about your shitty story, Steve, but I promise I will never bring up defecation for the rest of this episode, okay?
I sure hope not, because that was pretty gross, and I would hate to dive deep bit more into that.
Steve, what do you got for us this week?
Well, Craig, this episode is all about Krusty the Clown and, you know, his father, who was a rabbi. So Krusty is the son of a rabbi. And, well, what if he was of a different religion? What if he was the son of a Baptist? So that's why I have, from Epic Brewing out of Denver, Colorado, a son of a Baptist coffee stout with cacao nibs. Now, Epic is known for their Big Bad Baptist. It's a barrel-aged stout. And this is kind of its little child, the son of a Baptist, which is a coffee stout that's made with a rotating artisanal coffee. And the copy reads, Son of a Baptist is an 8% ABV imperial stout. It's not barrel-aged like its father. Instead, its flavor profile was designed to highlight the complex and unique flavors of small-batch coffee. And so they rotate local roasteries in Colorado to try different coffee flavors. And so every batch is a little bit different. And so I'm going to pour this out into a glass. I know we've done probably 101 coffee stouts, but they're always good. Has a really rich coffee flavor. Ooh, that's nice. This is a nice stout. What I like about it is the coffee flavor tastes almost more single origin, kind of. You get like the fruity notes of coffee in with that rich kind of malty stout flavor. Really well balanced. I could drink several of these until I'm shitting on the streets as well.
The audacity of you. Steve, was that actually you that was shitting in the streets?
Yeah, it was. But at least I asked for hand sanitizer.
That's why I was a little sus on that, because that sounds pretty much like you.
Craig, what have you got for us this week?
Well, Steve, this episode has to deal with clown college, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or clown school, not clown college. So when I think of clowns, you know, they have to put on the white makeup. And that comedy of theirs is pure gold, right?
Mm-hmm.
One could say the white makeup, the comedy of being pure gold, it's white gold. I'm going with White Gold Hazy Lager from Windmere Brothers.
Oh.
Do you remember Windmere?
A Portland classic.
Yeah, they got rid of their restaurant, but they still brew the beer. So it's just a hazy lager. I don't really have much info on this. The can is just a couple guys, some miners. Not the baby kind of miners, but like actual physical miners. So miners might like this can, but miners won't like this can. And they're looking for White Gold, which is just in a hazy lager.
Hmm.
Steve, generations in the making, this hazy gold wheat lager balances the scales with elegance, a flavor both crisp and smooth. Raise your glass. You've just struck gold. 35 IBUs with a 4.7% alcohol. Your standard fare of booze alcohol. Let's get this can of Kraken. Steve, will you be happy to know that the beer is gold?
I am very happy to hear that.
Yeah. Okay, so for a hazy lager, a lot of times it's a little too hoppy. And 35 is kind of like the number where it's the point of no return for hoppiness, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like under 35, you're not too hoppy. Over 35, it gets a little hoppy. There's a very smooth feel to this. And
it's the opposite for rabbits. When they get past 35, they're not so hoppy. Sounds very nice.
We're getting to the dog days of summer here, and actually, no, we haven't started summer yet. So we're getting to the puppy days of summer,
mm-hmm.
and Florence and the Machine would love this. Dog days of summer, it's their song. Look, the reason I bring that up, Steve, is they used that song in a movie that I just saw. Oh. Hey, Steve, what was the number one movie at the box office?
Well, Craig, once again, it was Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3.
And that's what I was bringing up. Dog days of summer, that's in the soundtrack.
Ah, very nice.
Yeah. I didn't see it again, Steve. So Chris Pratt just sitting there like, I don't know, comes home from a voiceover job or an acting job. And there's probably piles of money. And he's like, do I count my Guardians money or do I count my Mario money? That's what I imagine Chris Pratt does, right?
Yep. I'm just looking forward to next year when we can finally hear his rendition of Garfield.
Wait, is that a joke?
Nope.
Wait, he's doing Garfield next?
Yep.
Wow.
Probably this time next year it'll be out, I think.
He's really, it's a me, Garfield.
Lasagna, let's go.
Well, look, I'm sure it's great. I don't know what it is. They're making another Garfield movie? Is this a new universe?
I think so, a new Garfverse.
Is it going to be live action with, or is it just going to be like straight up animation like Mario and Lego and all those other ones he's done?
It looks like it is. You're going to like this movie, Craig.
Wait, let me guess. Rob McElhenney will be Odie, you know, because Charlie Day was Luigi. And
right.
It's always something.
Read you some of the cast members.
Okay. I didn't even know about this.
So I'll start. We got Bowen Yang.
Is he Dave or John Arbuckle?
I don't have names, unfortunately.
Okay.
Then we have Cicely Strong.
She'll be Liz.
Right. That would make sense.
Right.
We got Ving Rhames.
Definitely Normal. Because that would be hilarious if that was Normal. Right?
Yeah. We got the furball. We got Samuel L. Jackson.
No, that's Normal.
Yeah. We got Brett Goldstein.
Oh, Ted Lasso guy. Roy Kent.
Yeah.
Maybe he'll be Odie. Odie didn't talk, though.
That's true. He'll just growl.
Did any other... Are they going to use, like, the U.S. Acres characters, too? Or are they just doing Garfield?
Oh, maybe. So then we got Nicholas Hoult, the love About him. A Boy Boy. Yep, you love him. And, aside from Chris Pratt, the headliner of the movie is one, Hannah Waddingham.
Oh, my God. So they got two Ted Lasso stars.
Yeah, exactly. I am so curious as to what this movie is going to be.
I think Hannah would be, maybe she'll be like Arlene. Was that the cat Garfield had a boner for?
I could see that. Because, yeah, Cicely Strong is perfect Liz.
Yeah.
Hmm.
Oh, what a good cat. Yeah. What is this movie? Well, I guess we got an IF Springfield.
I think so.
Look, as a kid, I loved Garfield. So.
Me too. I had a Garfield lunchbox.
Yeah, I pretty sure I watched that first one with Bill Murray just because I had to watch it, and Breckenmeyer playing Jim.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved the cartoon as a kid, and I was even okay with the U.S. Acres. I know it sucked. I hated when it was on, but I still watched it.
And in retrospect, did it suck? I mean, I think it was kind of okay.
Who was the little duck with the little, he wore the little inflatable ring?
Right.
I liked him. He was cool.
And the chicken who was afraid to hatch. I thought that was cool.
Yeah. Sheldon. Was his name Sheldon?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's the real young Sheldon.
Very funny.
I can't wait till they do old Sheldon.
Mm-hmm.
But Steve, enough about Guardians. That's what we're talking about. It was great.
Oh, yeah.
I loved it.
While you were watching Guardians of the Galaxy, what were we all playing on our MP3 players?
Well, sadly, it's still Morgan Whalen. Wallen that last night, and I don't know if you guys remember this, but about a year, maybe two years ago he was caught in like some TV or like a security camera using the N-word.
Ooh.
Not nuclear. Other N-word that would and I guess he had to do an interview. So I just want to hear him talking to Michael Strahan. I like how it was on Good Morning America. So here he is apologizing.
What made you think that the word was ever appropriate to use?
I'm not sure. I think I was just ignorant about it. In our minds, it's playful. You know, I don't know. That sounds ignorant, but that's really where it came from. And it's wrong.
Wallen's album downloads actually spiked nearly 500% after the video leaked. In fact, Morgan, who says he donated $500,000 to black charities, is the best-selling overall artist in the U.S. so far this year.
Wait a second. So he's caught on camera using the N-word, and people were like, oh, there's so many gross people in this country.
It's awful. Like, it's bad enough that he could say the N-word and then a year later have the number one song on the Billboard Hot 100. But the fact that his sales spiked 500% after the clip came out, what is wrong with this country? That is awful. Oh, my God.
It just goes to show you that there's so many white supremacists in this country. I'm assuming that's who, unless it was, they said sales. They said sales. It wasn't like hits on YouTube. Like, well, who is this guy who said this? I can understand like that increasing because like how we were like doing research on him.
Right. They bought singles.
Good. I like this guy. Oh, my. You know, we really don't have listeners in this house, so I think we could keep talking this way and we're fine.
Yeah, yeah. And just like, the fact that I thought it was playful. What the fuck, man? That's awful.
Yeah. I don't like this guy.
Me neither.
Because, you know, he has to save face, you know, when on this interview, and he had all those like buzzwords to say, you know, to I was ignorant and that sort of, you know.
Yeah. More gun Whalen. I say less gun. Floor it out. I was good in the first half, but I lost it.
Yeah, but I guess just it's depressing to see that there's a lot of jerk asses out there. Like it's a group of people. Yeah,
it's just hard to believe, and I guess it's not hard to believe considering what we've seen over the past few years. But it's just crazy that people like that still exist this day and age, and that people still support them. It's
I just don't understand that mindset and that mentality. You know those people that are like, well, I like him because, you know, it's gross. It's all gross. It's
so gross.
Can we just find a better song to be the number one? Look, next week is the season finale. Spoilers. I don't want to start. Steve, forget what I'm about to say, okay?
Okay.
But next week will be the season finale of season 34 of Simpsons. So hopefully we'll have a different song.
I really hope so.
But at least we'll go into the summer with old episodes where we could hear, you know, hopefully non-controversial artists like, I don't know, Michael Jackson.
R. Kelly.
Kanye.
Kid Rock.
Arlo Guthrie.
There's nothing wrong with Arlo Guthrie.
Right Said Fred. Didn't he do something wrong?
No, I think he was just too sexy.
Oh, no. Who's that one guy that right. That guy.
Yeah, Ferris Bueller.
Yeah. Matthew Broderick. He just likes to drink and drive and kill people in his car.
Mm-hmm. That one deleted scene from Stuart Little. Oof.
We're just going to hear Rob Thomas and Santana for the whole summer.
Yeah.
Probably be the number one song. But let's not look forward to the future, to the past. Let's go to the now. Does that make sense? And talk about this week's episode, season 34, episode 21, Clown v. Board of Education, in which Krusty opens a school for clowning, which becomes the most successful thing he's ever done.
Wow.
Yeah. Steve, let's finish our drinks, come back and discuss the episode. How about that?
Sounds great.
We'll be right back. And we are back. Today we're talking about Clown v. Board of Education. This is the 21st episode of the 34th season. originally aired May 14th, 2023. May the 14th be with you, right? It's episode 749 in the show's run. Nerd code is OABF15, written by Jeff Westbrook, directed by Lance Kramer, and the showrunner is Al Jean.
Jeff Westbrook, you know, we've had him a few times recently, best known for his work on The Simpsons and Futurama. He's written 23 episodes of The Simpsons, and this will be the 11th we reviewed. We just reviewed Pingal a few weeks, or about a month ago, the Jacques episode, but also Girls Just Tryna Have Fun, the great Chalmers Skinner episode, The Road to Cincinnati, Let's Go Fly a Coot was one of our earlier episodes. Actually, that was earlier as in episode 208, The Wreck Relationship, Ned and Edna's Bland Agenda, The Deadliest Catch, Pranks and Greens, No Loan Again Naturally, and the earliest one that we reviewed is Kill Kill, Volumes 1 and 2.
Well, that's the earliest one he wrote that we reviewed.
That's right. That's
because that was our 204th episode.
Right. That was one of our many Christmas episodes that we did last year.
The first episode that he wrote that we reviewed was Ned and Enda's Blended Agenda. That was our 55th episode. I think
that's right.
You know, right around that time, we were kind of getting our stride.
Yeah, that's when we were not awful.
But then 56 to about 223, we were awful.
Yeah, but here's to being good, maybe.
All right. Well, Steve, we got a title gag. It's a Dr. Seuss-inspired Fat in a Hat. He flies across the screen with his winged unicycle. And the only other appearance in Fat in a Hat is from the The Places You'll Doe from season 25's Treehouse of Horror, 24. So reaching into the old Simpsons well, they are.
It's true. And it's kind of interesting because, you know, throughout the course of this podcast, we've watched a lot of episodes of The Simpsons, especially like the more modern ones that we would have missed. And so it's interesting to see a character that we've not experienced yet.
Right. We haven't experienced it.
Right. But we will someday. So our episode begins, as it always does, on the stage of the Krusty the Clown Show. Sideshow Mel, playing the role of Juliet, calls out for his fare Krusty-O, and Krusty appears behind him, paraphrasing a different Shakespeare play to a mediocre response.
To pie or not to pie? That is no question! Well, the crickets get it, and they're the toughest insects to please. But what happened to my audience? This is supposed to be a kid's show!
Sorry, Krusty. Kids are no longer into your show.
Yeah, kids prefer TikTok, Instagram, going to church, dentist appointments, even getting bullied.
The only way we can get an audience is to bring in loose seniors who are lost at the mall.
We were lied to! We were promised air conditioning!
There is air conditioning!
Turn it down! I'm freezing!
Okay, so maybe I did lose touch with my audience in the 90s. What year is this? 2000 and what? I need new material. Where are my writers? They're buried where?
Oh. I wonder if I could enhance that audio and hear what...
Oh, to see if it's actual whispering.
Where are my writers?
They're all buried in front.
They're buried where?
Oh, we could. So what did they say?
Sounds like they're buried in front.
They were buried in front. I just started buried in front.
Almost Florida, but yeah, it is a little gibberishy.
Can I enhance anymore? Here's the most enhance I could do.
Where are my riders?
They were buried in front.
They're buried.
Maybe Forest Hills. Isn't that?
Oh, yeah.
Cemetery of the Stars?
Yeah.
I bet it was.
Yeah, I think you're right. Well done, CSI.
I zoomed and enhanced.
It's like a little hacker you are.
Yeah. Well, while the camera was spinning around me and there was like music going in the background.
And instead of using your mouse at all, you're just clacking wildly at your keyboard.
God.
To a black and green screen for some reason.
How many people actually type on their keyboard if they're not typing a letter?
Right, exactly.
It's like I use a mouse. But I guess if you use like an old, was it the Linux systems, but you're typing, I'm afraid to touch this keyboard. It'll probably mess something up with the recording.
That's true.
Krusty there, out of touch with reality. That's the Krusty that we don't love.
Yeah, it's fun. I don't want to go into joke jail necessarily. And I know the idea of the Shakespeare sketch is supposed to be hacky. But is Romeo and Juliet and making fun of it, is that a little tired? But I guess not. I guess that's kind of the whole joke of the thing.
Yeah, I don't think it's...
No, it's fine.
And yeah, I think it's totally acceptable. I like how they could play off the when he finds out it's year 20 what, and then he, you know, he could rerun this for a few more years and it'll still be relevant.
Yeah,
until like the next century when it's 21 something, it won't be because you know this show's gonna keep going till,
oh yeah, for sure,
the 22nd century at least. AI is gonna do all the voices.
I don't know if we want to talk about that right now.
It's true.
Given the current events of the world. While we have nothing to do with showbiz whatsoever, we support the writers.
Yes.
Their demands, because they're completely fair and reasonable. Not a locally union political podcast.
Listen, we're not scabs.
That's right.
I mean, for the right money, we might be.
Yeah. We may be communists. We may be homosexuals. We may be scabs, but we're not Democrats. Also starts on the running gag of the whispers, which is kind of fun.
Are you saying there's more whispers in this episode?
Perhaps there might be.
I might have to do some more CSI-ing.
You might.
Well, Krusty then heads to Muscle and Frank's. It's a parody of Musso and Frank's, right?
Mm-hmm.
When I was in L.A. this last September, this was one of the places I wanted to go to, but didn't get it on our agenda. Too many things to do, so that was maybe next time, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they had to Muscle and Frank's. It's the restaurant where a tourist rub elbows with the has-beens. So he sits with the clown chums, including Scuzzo and Crusto. Another clown tells Krusty that the heyday of TV clown ended when parents found out that Ovaltine was just sugared mud. Steve, I ordered you some Ovaltine, and there you go. You know, I've never had Ovaltine.
Neither have I.
And I think you probably, the same reason why I haven't had it is because of that movie, Christmas Story. Like, he just made Ovaltine like sound gross.
Yeah.
Because it's just like, what, powdered chocolate milk?
Right. I imagine it's like Nestle Quick, but worse. Or sorry, Nesquik, but worse.
It's like just cocoa powder, but they didn't put sugar in it. They put like flaxseed in it. Like, yeah, it's probably good for the kid.
Ooh, carob.
Is Ovaltine still in production, Steve? Do you want me to find out?
I'll find out. Ovaltine.
Okay, cool. This is what our fans want to know. Can you buy Ovaltine at your local Kroger's or... Yeah, it's Ovaltine only Kroger's, right?
Is a brand of milk flavoring product made with malt extract, sugar, and whey. Some flavors also have cocoa.
So I was close with the flaxseed. I don't know.
Yeah, no, you're not that wrong. It's still being made, but it's probably more popular in Europe because it is a registered trademark of Associated British Foods, and it is made by a subsidiary of Twinings, which is a tea company.
Twinings? It just sounds like an annoying TikTok phrase.
Twinning. Hashtag twinning. It's actually owned by Nestle in the U.S. So Nestle Quick also owns Ovaltine. So they have a monopoly of crappy powder. Ew. There's a picture of on the Wikipedia page of like just it in powder form. And I got to say, it does look like sugared mud.
Yeah, I don't think I'll go out and get some Ovaltine anytime soon.
No, I don't think so.
It just sounds like it'll make you pretty regular.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that was probably it, because, you know, back in the 40s and 30s when they're feeding their kids, it was just like clog-inducing, you know, just the meats and potatoes, cheeses, probably clogs up their system. And you gotta crap it out, so give them some Ovaltine.
Yep, Ovaltine and a pack of cigarettes and you're good to go.
I would not like to shit in the past.
Like, no.
Right now we're living in the golden age of defecation because of bidets.
Oh, like, God.
I still can't believe I didn't have a bidet for about, let's say, 30 years of my life, maybe more.
It is one of the biggest innovations of my life.
And when you go and you have to do a number two in public and you have to use a rough paper, you're like, I forget how to wipe, honestly.
Yeah, and it's hard because usually when you're out in public and you need to use the loo, and yeah, it's the worst toilet paper and no bidet. It's horrible.
Like, you could get an easy, cheap bidet attachment for pretty much every toilet for like $20 on like Amazon,
yeah,
right?
Right.
And they're really easy to install. So I'm just thinking I'm going to carry around one of those in my car. So if I have to go to a public restroom, I'll just bring it in with me. Give me like 5 minutes. So I could attach it real quick.
I think that might be my act of like polite revolution, is I'm just going to start installing bidets around the city under the shadow of night. And I'll like, that's my graffiti.
We'll be the bidet bros.
Yeah, I like it.
You could be a bat bidet and I'll be Robin Day.
I like it.
But we're still going to dress up like Batman and Robin, but with like toilets instead of a bat symbol. Yeah. And I'm talking like Adam West Batman, not like.
Right, of course. Holy squirts, Batman.
Look, and I know I was saying I install them in public restrooms, you know, bringing one of those kits. And I know they have like those travel ones.
Mm-hmm.
They're just not the same.
No.
Unless it's like one of those battery powered. Cause I've purchased one where it's, you know, you have to like squeeze it.
And, oh,
like, there's,
right.
There's like no pressure. I'm like, it's not going to get anything off.
Yeah. It's just like somebody spitting water into your butthole.
Which, you know, a lot of public restrooms, you could probably find a guy to do that for you.
Oh, do it.
But yeah, I don't know how we got a bidet talks. Oh, I was just saying, you know, Ovaltine.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know how people... And, like, you know, just, like, dingleberries must have been common. Like,
mm-hmm.
I just don't imagine that everyone's asshole was that clean back in the 30s and 40s.
Do you think the millennial and Gen Z rise of analingus has to do with the cleanliness of the nation's buttholes?
Yeah, you never saw, you know...
What a dumb sentence.
Well, I mean, think about it. You never heard, like, Clark Gable talking about his ass getting eaten because no one would want to eat his ass.
Yeah. Jimmy Stewart was like, never like, eat my ass.
No guy was like, I'm going to eat Marilyn Monroe's asshole tonight.
Right.
I'm pretty sure Joe DiMaggio did. Oh, well, maybe Arthur C. Clarke did, but...
No, Arthur Miller.
No, I'm just stick with Arthur C. Clarke. You know, he was in science fiction. He's like,
He was in a few other things, too.
Truman Capote probably liked eating ass.
Probably.
You know, coming to think of it, there's probably a lot of ass eaters out there. Cesar Romero definitely loved eating ass.
Yeah, I could see Ernest Hemingway chowing down on some brown.
The old man and the asshole.
Yeah, the old man and the bee.
Hey, tell us who do you think liked to eat ass in the olden days? Email us at 138simpsons@gmail.com or just tag us on social media, hashtag old ass eaters.
Please do this.
Yes, everyone, please do this. All right. You know, just who liked eating ass and who liked getting their ass eaten. I'm thinking like a Betty Page. She might like her asshole lick.
Yeah, I can see that.
Yeah. But, you know, I wouldn't go back in time and do it just because I just don't trust their
habits. Yeah.
Of asshole. I mean, they didn't even have baby wipes, right?
Right.
Because I was using baby wipes for like probably 10 years before the bidet. I don't know. Just one more question about defecation real quick. So in Star Trek universe, do you think they just transport shit out? Like they don't actually sit down on a toilet?
Oh, that's an excellent question. Yeah, you're probably right.
Although now I'm thinking about it, I remember watching an episode of Discovery and they talked about they were eating an apple and an admiral's all like, good, isn't it? Yeah. And then someone's like, yeah, it's just shit. What? Like, yeah, we just, you know, everything is like processed on their space station and it's like it's matter and then replicated into like edible matter.
So it's how they like maintain their food quality is they just transfer their waste into new food.
Yeah. Because they need some sort of like physical like material.
I mean, it's the 25th century. You'd think that they would have that technology. So I think by that time, I'd be okay with that.
You know, and it's like Dune, you know, the still suits in Dune, like their sweat and piss and shit gets all absorbed in those still suits and gives people in the desert nutrients. That's why they don't need water.
Hmm.
Yeah, that's the technology I'm looking forward to.
Yeah.
Except just like walking around like, yeah, I'm just shitting and pissing myself. But it's cool because it's being absorbed into my body for nutrients. Well, you know, we've talked a long time about shit and piss. We should just go back to The Simpsons.
Probably, yeah.
Yeah, there's the clowns. We're talking about these clowns here. So Scuzzo, you know, was talking about, he's lamenting that the clowns who have gotten out of the haha game, because, you know, it ended when Ovaltine. That's how we got it. It's The Simpsons' fault we get into these tangents, right?
It's true.
We're not bored of The Simpsons. It's they're creating conversation for us.
And, exactly.
That's what this podcast is. Why am I describing this podcast to the listener? All right, so the clowns that have gotten out of the game, we got Oingo.
Boingo.
Penny Nichols.
Nick Knack.
Patty Whack.
The cast of The View, which includes Whoopi Goldberg, Sarah Haynes, Alyssa, Sarah Griffin, Anna Navarro, Joy Behar, and Sonny Hostin.
What was your favorite era of The View?
I gotta go OG, Barbara Walters, Rosie O'Donnell, Whoopi, and the rest.
What, you're not a talk household?
Oh, yeah, I love that Julie Chen and anybody else on the talk.
Well, wasn't it so Sarah Gilbert for a long for
oh
a while
yeah that's
on, right,
right? Yeah,
wasn't Sharon Osbourne also on the talk at some point?
Yeah,
did any of them like cross like switch? Did I feel like Whoopi Goldberg left, or because is Whoopi Goldberg still on The View? Or she says some weird shit and then
yeah.
people try to cancel her, but then they can't because you know she's an EGOT or
right, and
you can't cancel the EGOTs.
Nope,
you can't cancel the EGOTs. Yeah, I don't know. There's also Dungaree Dave.
And Sadzy, when I'm sad to see Sadzy go.
You look kind of happy about it.
I'm a little happy. I didn't like Sadzy.
I like Oingo Boingo is great. Did one of them look like Danny Elfman?
I think so, yeah.
You know, they said knick-knack paddywhack, and I was just waiting to get that bone for a dog.
And, you know, Krusty's especially bummed to see Leaky Pants quit, saying that he was born to be a clown. Why, when his mother's water broke, it was salty. Just then, Leaky Pants arrives at the table as a server and offering to shed some cheese atop Krusty's scampi. Krusty's distraught and offers to buy Leaky's material for $7,800. Leaky declines, so Krusty decides to just steal it. Krusty looks to the clown sitting to the right of him, not to the left of him, because he would be stuck in the middle with him. He sees the wise and aged little Debbie Dimples. She says she's as cute as and adorable as ever, and then shows off her trademark pout, which is actually a frightening and painful smile. Really good animation there. After a coughing fit, Debbie offers Krusty some advice, which gives him an idea.
What we need is new young clowns. But who's teaching them? Nobody.
Wait a minute. If I started a school for clowns, I could save our profession. But would I make money? What's private school tuition these days?
Yeah, hey, you can sell the students comedy props like those dollar sign contacts you're wearing.
It's not a prop. It's scarring from a drive-through LASIX clinic. Little tip, put the car in park. Dimples, this school idea is genius. Any more advice?
Yes. The most important thing in comedy is...
What? Fine, don't tell me. What is it? What could it be? Why won't she tell me? Is it being funny? Is it big shoes? What?
So we got some more whispering.
Can you give me a little, like, music?
Dun, 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 dun.
Sure.
Dun, 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 dun.
Some typing sound effects. Okay, here. Okay. I got it, team. Here we go.
Okay.
It's creepy as it is. It's like a Beatles album, you know, just like it's saying Paul's dead. Should I reverse it? Maybe they'll say Paul is dead. Okay, let's see what that's like here.
Tuition these days.
Well, I just heard Satan there.
Yeah.
Oh, wait, no. Wait, hold on, sir. Oh, no, sorry. That wasn't the clip. I was just playing a clip of a Kenneth Copeland sermon. But yeah, I guess we kind of heard some sort of $1,000. It wasn't as clear as that first one, the Forest Hill Cemetery. But
Yeah.
And then we have the joke of timing being the most important part, of course, joke. And when I saw this last night, first time, I was like, okay, well, this is definitely the stinger. She's going to come back at the end of the episode, spoilers, and say timing. Is this a joke, Jail?
Part of me feels like it is, but also I kind of feel like it's so bad that you're just waiting for the payoff and then it comes and you're like, yeah, there it is. So I'm a little torn on it.
Okay, Natalie Imbruglia. Yeah, I think everyone knows, like a three-year-old knows the most important part of comedy is timing.
Yeah, I think so.
You know who doesn't know the most important thing in comedy is timing is Greg Gutfeld. I don't know.
I mean, it's true. He does say a joke poorly, but also the writing's bad. So
hey, it's a good thing. You know, all the late night talk shows are off the air because of the support of the WGA. But Gutfeld's on because he doesn't have writers that are in the WGA.
Very true. He sucks.
Yeah, can we go back to I was watching more of the food on the table here.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, Krusty just has a plate of noodles with some mushrooms and then, like, shrimp just circling the...
It's weird because I noticed that, too, because it's a shrimp scampi.
Yeah.
Which is fine because it's, like, basically what? Mushrooms and... Or, sorry, shrimp in, a garlicky butter sauce.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Why are there mushrooms on there?
I mean, he probably added mushrooms. But... What if it's, like, macaroni grill where you can, add toppings? You know...
Maybe, yeah.
You get, like, the base... Like a noodles company where you just get the base and you say, well, I want, the shrimp scampi, but add some mushrooms and broccoli, whatever you want to. But also, mm-hmm. That's like way too much noodle for shrimp scampi.
Yeah, it's a big pile of noodle.
And no one's eating their food because like one of the clowns has like this big like ribeye steak there.
Yeah.
Taters and peas. And, cartoon food used to not look good. Like old school Simpsons cartoon food, like first couple mm-hmm. seasons, not good. This looks really good, though. Like that steak looks good. And then, I don't know what that is over there.
But the potatoes look pretty tasty. Yeah.
I'm not even hungry, but now I just want, honestly, want to eat the mushrooms, shrimp, and pasta. Like if it's, a lemony, garlicky, buttery noodle or even a cream sauce.
That does sound tasty.
Great. Yeah. Some shrimp and some of the, some nice mushrooms. Oh, that sounds pretty good. All right. So Krusty then pays a visit to our favorite mayor, Mayor Quimby, and Superintendent Chalmers is there. He's looking to get the approval for the clown school. So a good old Diamond Joe there states that Krusty will need psychological evaluations and educational degrees. So Krusty attempts to bribe the mayor with an envelope of cash, but Quimby now only accepts bribes through apps such as Grifter, PayPal, and Instagraft.
So Chalmers wonders, what about the curriculum that Krusty will be teaching? Will he be offering STEM? And Krusty replies that he sure will. Slapstick, tumbling, enormous shoes, and mime. Chalmers is disgusted by the thought of mime and mimics shooting himself in the head. It's like, didn't somebody last week shoot themselves in the head?
Yeah, his best friend Skinner.
That's right. Krusty's impressed with Gary's work and offers him a teaching position, and then Gary pantomimes hanging himself. And Krusty offers him an imaginary contract to sign. He then mimes that wind is blowing the papers away and tells Super Nintendo Chalmers to catch them and put them in his magic box. I don't know if I've talked about this, but in fifth grade in my elementary school, we had a 2-week mime course that our whole class did. So for an hour a day for 10 days, we did miming. And I don't know why.
Was your teacher a actor?
No, she was she lent more into the arts, visual arts. But she wanted us, I guess, to have a whole spectrum of artistic education. And so, yeah, she had some guy come in who was a mime. And he would teach us how to be in a box or how to walk against the wind.
Well, if you go to if you want to be a serious actor, you got to learn clowning. You got to learn mime.
Mm hmm.
Because your whole body is, that's your tool.
Right.
So it's interesting because I've listened to Gates McFadden, who played Dr. Beverly Crusher on Star Trek The Next Generation. She has a podcast, and it's really, really good interview podcast because she talks to other people from the Star Trek universe, but they don't talk about Star Trek.
Mm-hmm.
And so a lot of times they talk about the process of acting, and it's very fascinating. And she studied clown, and she likes to talk about clown and masks and all that kind of actory type of things. And, she had Anson Mount, who is on the new Star Trek Stranger Worlds. And they were just hear them talking about doing clowning and things like that. It's very fascinating.
Yeah.
So I was really interested in watching this episode because it's a thing. I mean, when people say you're going to clown college as an insult when you were a kid.
Right.
It's they teach clown in Juilliard. So
mm-hmm. Can I tell you, I have this weird prediction about where comedy is going. And I think the next wave of popular comedy is going to be female led clowning. I think that's where comedy is going. I think that the idea of a person standing on stage doing stand-up and looking at a notebook while wearing a hoodie and talking about going grocery shopping, that's done for because it's boring and it's been done to death. And so I think that people want performance. And I think that there's going to be a big thing of female performers with, unique voices performing. You look at Sarah Sherman or Sarah Squirm, she has kind of a classic clown thing that she does, but it's obviously absurdist and kind of gross and that's kind of a thing. But also, Natalie Palamides had a special on Netflix a couple years ago that was very weird and very, where she played a whole character named Nate, but it's also kind of rooted in clown performance. And I really think that there's a lot of schools in, like, in LA and stuff that are teaching clowning and kind of more traditional tomfoolery in their education rather than stand-up. And I think that's kind of where we might be going. So I feel like in a few years from now, we're going to say The Simpsons predicted it with clown schools.
Hey, look, in this podcast, everyone calls us clowns for doing it. So
exactly.
We're right there.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think there's a stigma with clowns. Maybe Stephen King was kind of at fault.
Yeah.
Because he created it, Pennywise the Clown, as a scary thing. But there was also like creepy clown movies, like the killer clowns from outer space in the 80s. So there's always been this like stigma with clowns being scary.
Right.
And clowns originally, of course, were there to entertain. And clowns were big on TV in the 50s. You know, that's why Krusty exists, because Matt Groening created Krusty based off of a local clown here on Portland's TV. Rusty Nails. Was it Rusty Nails?
Yeah, Rusty Nails. Rusty Nails. Horrible name.
So, you know, everything kind of comes back.
Mm-hmm.
So I could see like what you're saying about Sarah Squirm and Natalie Palamides, that we have like, there's been just so much like that snarky comedian like walking on stage, like you're saying.
Yeah.
That we've seen enough of that, you know, it's time to breathe. Yeah. Just take something old, like you're saying, and make it fresh and new. So it'll be
because you think about it, like when Krusty tried to be an edgy stand-up comic, that was way back in season 9, The Last Temptation of Krust. That was like, you know, 1998. And that was like when it was a new thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so here we are over 20 years later, like 25 years later. And, you know, it's time for a different kind of performance.
I'd like to see that prediction come true.
I hope so.
All right. Well, the Herschel Krestovsky School for the Clowning Art opens in the very studios where the Krusty the Clown Show was once filmed. And inside, Krusty appears on stage like a sillier version of General Patton, a reference that no kids get, telling his potential teachers that clowning is now the most despised profession after Supreme Court judge. I really like that joke.
Mm-hmm.
But he vows to lift his clown horn high and tell the world, "Agazooga!"
Perfect.
The clowns rally and the school is ready to begin. But over at 742 Evergreen Terrace, the Simpsons see an ad for this goofy house of education.
Tired of your kids being jammed into overcrowded public school classrooms with teachers who only work 9 months a year?
Ready to work on our lesson plan?
I plan to lessen the amount of margarita in this pitcher.
Teachers, they have it so easy. They get to buy their own classroom equipment, and people tell them what they can and can't teach. What a racket.
Then bring your kids to the Herschel Krestovsky School for the Clowning Arts. You'll receive a fully rounded education. Math, science, balloon animals, and the basics of stilt safety. And advanced balloon animals. And we've got one thing no other school has. An elephant. Barnum and Bailey's had to sell this guy after an unfavorable documentary. And I got him!
I have to go there!
I love the dig at the education system of this country that Homer says.
Yeah, it's
And we've talked about this so many times on this podcast.
Yeah, but I do like how, I was thinking about how, like, the past two episodes that we watched, you know, we were talking about the pandemic or the lockdown and then houselessness in America. And I was like, oh, this episode's about clowns. It's not going to be political or, like, have a lot of satire of our modern times. But then Homer has to go and, like, make a poignant remark about the schooling system. So, yeah, I thought it was good.
Right. Pay the teachers more.
Yeah.
And Simpsons podcasters, pay them more too.
Pay them some.
Just pay them.
Yeah, exactly. Spotify. I liked all the stuff going on in the background too as Krusty was walking. Balloon DNA helix and all the clown theory. It was a lot of fun. Really well done.
I like Nancy's read of the I have to go there, like just the pauses.
Mm-hmm.
Just the I don't know the last time you saw Bart was so enthusiastic about something, but just those reading of, you know, those five words that everything just is conveyed through that emotion of Bart really wanting to go to something, like just the excitement.
Mm-hmm.
Like, have you ever felt that excited? Like, he wants to learn, you know, that's the most amazing thing about it. It's not like you're seeing like an ad for Disneyland. Of course we want to go there, but just for something where he, you know, because when it comes down to it too, in this episode, where he's like, we'll be learning math and history and kind of getting to the point of what you were trying to say is like, this is how, like in a lot of European countries, like the STEM programs or schooling, it is geared to kids' specific interests,
mm-hmm.
but they still learn, you know, along the way, basics, fundamentals, where just our schooling system is, we'll teach you everything, you know, it's glorified babysitting. And sadly, I don't mean that in a negative way.
No, but you're not wrong.
Because the public school system in this country is a joke. Because look at it, that's how we went.
Look at us now.
Yeah. It's just, you know, the public school teachers, pay them more.
Mm-hmm.
I just think it's so weird that they have to buy their own supplies.
It's so messed up. Like, on top of, like, basically having to be, like, a third parent.
Yeah.
And, you know, the psychological baggage that comes with. And then having to, you know, worry that the kids that you're trying to teach have enough supplies to just do the most basic work. It's tragic, really.
I'd be scared to be, like, an elementary school teacher. Because I would just be thinking the whole time, like, these parents, there's 30 kids in my class, and I have to worry about their lives. I would just be afraid, like, if something goes wrong under my watch. These aren't my kids, you know. We're not going to get into it. I don't want to, but asshole Republicans saying, well, you know, now I'm talking about like gun violence, like arm the fucking teachers. Fuck you.
Yeah.
That's not going to solve anything, you piece of shit, Ted Cruz.
Right. And then like arguing against like free lunch programs. Like, ugh. Jesus Christ, you ghoul.
The Republican parties only want fetuses alive. George Carlin said it the best. As long as when that baby's born, they didn't give a shit about what happens to that baby when it's born.
Yep. They're pro-birth, not pro-life.
Yeah, exactly.
Ugh.
R.I.P. George Carlin. We miss you.
Yeah, you're the best.
God, I wish he was still alive just during the whole Trump administration.
Oh, yeah.
He died before Trump even was elected, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, he died in like, what, the 2010s, maybe?
Probably, yeah.
Yeah. But we're not talking about that stuff. You guys all know our view on this shit. We bring it up every time, but let's just get back to The Simpsons where it's funny.
Yeah, exactly. Marge feels that Bart is doing fine at Springfield Elementary, but Bart thinks otherwise and has notes from his teachers to prove it. The notes say, failing, see me, dumber than class hamster, and school psychologist in tears. Bart thinks this could be the opportunity to turn his sucked up life around and be like Lisa, but fun. Lisa objects to Bart's characterization of her, but he actually points to the book that she's reading, You Aren't Their God, I Give Up Margaret. That's a great take on the Judy Blume classic. Lisa rescinds her objection.
Hey, and there's a new movie that no one's out watching. The Are You There, God? It's Me, Margaret. They made a live-action movie.
Oh, did they really?
Yeah, it's like literally in theaters right now.
Wow, I have not even heard of that.
I even saw Judy Blume was on, like, I think Colbert. You know, your good pal Colbert.
Mm-hmm, I saw him once. I met him.
Yeah, Judy Blume. Again, not a Judy Blume podcast, but
mm-hmm.
I mean, that was my childhood too. Like, I loved all of those Tales of the Fourth Grade Nothing books.
Super fudge.
Yeah. And wasn't Margaret part of that universe?
I think that might have been a different one.
There was the Great Ramona, I think, was part of the Fudgiverse.
That's Beverly Cleary, I think. Ramona. Cleary. Yeah, Portland Zone.
Right. I always get that confused. I always think, is Judy Blume also from Portland? But no, that was Beverly Cleary. Beverly Cleary, but just passed away too, like a few years ago, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyways, Bart tells Marge and Homer that they need to straighten him out. If it's not clown school, it'll be Catholic school. And then Bart begins to chant in Latin, and Homer and Marge recoil in fear. The message Bart speaks translates to, we praise you, God. We acknowledge you as our Lord.
Ugh.
Let all the earth worship thee, the Ugh. Eternal Father. To you, all the angels, heaven, and all powers to you. So terrified, Marge agrees to let Bart try out clown school. It's very funny. They're Christian.
Mm-hmm.
I was thinking something like Christians, like every other sect of Christianity, like Catholics still weird, like those Christians out.
Yeah, like all the flavors are a little weird, but yeah, Catholics, they go to 11, I think.
It's like, and every time you see like a Catholic service portrayed on TV, it just looks so like boring and
mm-hmm.
like, you know, baptisms and weddings and like, you know, it's all in ceremony and it doesn't look fun.
No, it looks horrible. No one's having fun. No.
And Catholics,
the line is weak.
Yeah. Yeah, Jesus, you got some weak blood there. I think, does that mean if you got some weak blood, like you need like iron deficiency?
I think he has a pretty good amount of iron, especially in his wrists and feet.
Yeah. Oh, you're like hypoglycemic.
Yeah.
Like low blood glucose.
Right. So he needs to stop eating his own body and start eating some sugar.
Yeah. Jesus, just, hey, you know, Carrie Underwood, you're talking about Jesus taking the wheel. Jesus needs to take a Snickers break. He doesn't need to drive. Give Jesus Snickers. Hey, Snickers, great commercial for you. Get Jesus in it.
Yeah. You can turn into Joe Pesci or something.
No, it should be like, no. Let's make it so controversial. Let's make it like Jesus is actually like Lil Nas X. Could you just imagine like the right?
Oh, yeah.
Is Lil Nas X the, is he gay? Is it, he's the gay rapper?
Yeah.
The gay rapper.
I don't know that he's the gay rapper, but he is a rapper who is gay.
Wait a minute. Why isn't Chase the rapper? Because he'd be Chase the candy rapper and promote to Snickers.
There you
like,
go.
There's the bit. He's like, I'm Chase the rapper, but when I get my Snickers, I'm Chase the candy rapper. I don't know. Is that dumb?
Actually, I wonder if he's dumb or not. It's not dumb because he did it for Kit Kat.
Oh.
It's Chance the rapper at a convenience store, and he's the rapper of a Kit Kat bar. So it's a great idea.
And it's been done. Huh.
Yeah.
All right.
Huh. But good idea.
Simpsons did it.
That's right. Simpsons did it. Speaking of, Homer and Bart meet up with Krusty to apply for the school, but Krusty feels that Bart's grades are nothing to hey about and tells him to sell himself. Bart states that he was voted class clown 3 years running, which impresses Krusty, who only ever won an in memoriam segment along with Sir Alec Guinness and Carol Channing. Krusty was happy to see his face up there, even if it did get booed.
Steve, I think we have a blunder there.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. Carol Channing died in January of 2019, and the good old Obi-Wan himself, he died in 2000. So big discrepancy there about, 19 years.
Yeah.
Al Guinness died in 2000, so at least he was alive to see Phantom Menace, right?
That's why he died.
I'm going to say he probably didn't see Star Wars. I don't think he saw any of the Star Wars movies.
No. Was just too busy with his Book of World Records.
You know, Alec Guinness. I like to do anagrams. And I think of Alec Guinness, I think of genuine class.
Sure, sure.
I'm going to do one. You have to do one for me now. Jeremy Iron.
Jeremy's Iron.
Steve, here's a ball. You want to go play with it?
Yeah. I dropped it. In the in memoriam, though, it was kind of cool to see, we were talking about it earlier, but the edgy stand-up comedy Krusty of The Last Temptation of Krust.
Mm, that's how I look now, just long ponytail, baldy in the front there.
Mm-hmm. And you'd sell your soul to get a Canyonero.
Yeah, I think I would. Well, insurance might be too expensive.
That's true.
All right. Well, Krusty feels that Bart's application has the stink of a loser, but Homer has a point to make. So Bart may be a loser, but he's an alpha loser, unlike Steve and I, who are beta losers.
That's right.
The one that all the other losers blindly follow, the alpha loser. Just then, Milhouse steps in with his father saying that whatever Bart is joining, he's also joining. And Kirk then offers all of his pin numbers.
Yeah.
Am I allowed to say pin numbers?
I guess so. It's common usage by now.
All right. Well, saying that, he'll pay whatever it takes. Bart has shown Krusty that the bottom of the barrel is lined with gold. He then asks Bart to bring him every rotten apple in the barrel. So as Krusty looks over all the new applications, he is greeted by another star of Springfield.
Krusty Manon Pal. Showbiz man hug. I want to present my son, Dieter. I think he would be an excellent candidate for your academy.
Shut up, Dad! You has been!
Enough of the Weisenheiming. My son is a special boy. So special, no decent school would take him. But he has a gift for the comedy. Like me. We Germans have a word for it. Komische Einstellung. Strike and hold tense in Lebensfranzer.
Wow!
I wasn't finished. Eine Wuschgangsteifel. Let's cut to the chase. Are we in?
I don't know. We got a lot of applications.
Yeah.
Oh, he's in all right. That's Malibu rehab money.
Son, let's get you some ice cream and a new Lamborghini.
Whatever.
Holy crap. I can afford another marriage. And just in time.
So Rainier has at least two kids that we know of now, right?
So this is the first appearance of a Dieter, who looks like a cross between Uter and I was just trying to find his name, but from March Be Not Proud, the one who doesn't, who wants the second copy of Bone Storm so he doesn't have to share.
I was going to bring him up, but they should be best friends.
Yeah, exactly. So there's Greta Wolfcastle, played by Reese Witherspoon from season 13's The Bart Wants What It Wants. And then there's Dieter. And then there's a third unnamed child who I believe is younger, maybe a baby or a toddler.
Yeah. Better by two, because I'm not sharing with Caitlin.
Yeah.
he must be the happiest kid or boy in town.
Yeah. So funny how when you're a kid, you think that's so true. It's like, oh, they have so much money. They must be so happy.
Right. Right. Going over to your friend's house where it's like nice and clean and not a shithole like yours growing up. And
yeah.
He's got like all the G.I. Joes.
Mm-hmm.
He's got like the turtle blimp. But then like that kid would be like, you'd be like, can I play with it? I'm like, no. I'm like, well, you're not really my friend, are you?
Right. Exactly. I'm a lonely prick.
Hey, do you want to know how good of a friend Steve is? I'm going to bring this up real quick.
Oh,
back
boy.
In like high school, you had a PlayStation and we used to play like hockey and like Duke Nukem and a bunch of those games. You let me borrow it for a weekend.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't have a PlayStation. I was like, man, this is really fun. Like, you let me borrow it for like a weekend. I had to bring it back, of course, but yeah.
Happy to do so.
Yeah. Oh, I'll bring it back, Steve. I still have it.
You better. I still want to beat that level of Crash Bandicoot.
Steve, I've told you, right? I still have all my PS1 games.
That's cool.
I still have my NES. And you know I have my NESs.
Yeah.
I don't think I've ever gotten rid of a video game, except for my PS3. I sold all those games and to help buy the PS4.
That seems fair, though. I feel like in the pantheon of consoles, the PS3 will probably not go down as like the biggest one in history.
Well, I think at the time it was huge.
Yeah, but like the PS2 kind of had like more or less the power. And of course, the PS4 right. is still, you know, the PS5 is still around. PS4 is still very popular.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, because I still use the PS4. But it is getting close to that time where like, well, PS4, you know, now that PS5s are getting a little bit more easy to get, might have to turn it in, right?
Yeah, it might be that time.
I'm more of I'm doing more Xbox One these days, so, which is a better system than PS4.
It really is.
I don't know. I guess Spider-Man 2, when that comes out on PS5, I think it's when you really got
to. That's kind of what I'm thinking bullet, is right? Like, that's going to be the thing that pushes me over the edge to buying a new PS5.
Right.
Are they available now, like to buy? Like, can you just buy one?
I don't know.
I mean, either.
Like the Hogwarts game that came out, which I, of course, wouldn't buy. You know, that was only on Xbox One and PS5. So even if I wanted to, when it first came out, like, I think it was just now released on PS4 and Switch.
Yeah.
Yeah. Plus, I like the Xbox Live or the, this is tough for me to say because I've been a PS kid since, you know, PS1 when we were like in high school.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the games on the Xbox, like the streaming service might be a little better. Plus, they also do like I could actually play the newest NHL, the newest MLB games and not pay $60 for, you know, for those baseball or the sports games. And so that's nice that I can just play it, you know, and not have to buy the whole game.
That's true.
Yeah. Hey, when's Tapped Out coming to the PS5? That's all I care about.
Exactly.
We need a new Simpsons game, don't we?
We are far overdue for something. Like, I would love, we've talked about it before, but like an open world game where maybe you're a new resident to Springfield.
Yeah, we've brought that up. Like, that's how the game should be. It should be you create your own customized, like the Hogwarts games or, you know, create your character. I think it does need to be MMORPG. I think that's because I want to interact with, you know, real people.
Yeah.
And not just, make it free, open world. You know, obviously you have to pay for, you know, houses and things like, you know, better things, right? Like any MMORPG, right. You get the basics for free, but then, you know, it's a freemium game. Is that what they call? It's
yeah.
free,
yeah.
But there's still premium stuff. I mean, that's totally fine. I like that model for a Simpsons open world game.
Yeah, it makes sense.
I mean, that's how Tapped Out is, right? You have to buy donuts.
Or get them from Reddit.
Right. But yeah, it'd be great to, because yeah, it was not the concept was you get the house right next to the Simpsons house.
Mm-hmm.
And so like that's now your line, or the house across the street from the Simpsons. But like that's your properties. You can build a house, make it look whatever the way you want. But you're still going to be on Evergreen Terrace But then you get to explore the town.
Yeah.
And you go over to the Simpsons house. Like, Lisa has a quest for you. It's like, I need 6 butterflies. And they're located in these parts of Springfield. So you have to, like, catch butterflies. You know, something stupid like that.
Yeah, exactly.
You have to go bowling with Homer. It would just be a fun, like, no. There's, like, maybe there's a story, but it's mostly just, like, side quests.
Yeah, that's kind of what I like. World
games. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
You still unlock level, you know, unlock entrance to businesses and, you know, maybe can't go to Krusty Burger right away. You have to, like, level up to go to Krusty. You know, there's endless possibilities for this.
Yeah, and it's ever, like, you could just keep on adding DLC, too. Like, the world could be huge, and right. That's what's could be fun about it. It could be, like, the way that, like, my wife still plays Skyrim, mm-hmm. like, 10 years later. Like, it's just endlessly fulfilling, and I think that the Simpsons world would be, too.
It'd be great.
Speaking of The Simpsons, our second act begins with Krusty hanging pictures of great educators on his wall, such as...
We got Maria Montessero.
Mr. Cotter from Welcome Back, Cotter.
Jack Black's character from School of Rock.
Ned Schneebly. Well, not really, but yeah. Michelle Pfeiffer from Dangerous Minds.
And then, of course, Clippy, or the clip, the paperclip, the spoof of the Microsoft Clippy.
And we have Hyman Kraskowski, who was a rabbi, a teacher, and a disapproving father to Krusty.
Just like your father.
That's right. Rabbi Jim.
There was Reverend Jim on Taxi. Jesus, Christopher Lloyd, is that you?
What? Does?
All right. Great scene.
Yeah.
If you don't know, see, finish the joke so the fans don't know.
Okay. So
We'll do the bit.
Yeah. So Reverend Jim's taking his DMV test, and Jeff Conaway and Tony Danza and Mary Lou Henner are in the corner. And he goes,
what's his name?
Oh, no, it was Judd Hirsch. Yeah.
Judd Hirsch. I'll be Judd Hirsch. That's right.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm taking the test. I'm Reverend Jim.
And then I'm going to ask you a question. You ask me. No, yeah. Maybe it was Tim Conway. It was.
I think it was Judd Hirsch. Yeah. I think Tony Danza wasn't there. Or I don't know. But so I'm taking the test.
Right.
What does a yellow light mean?
Slow down.
What does.
You know, we should just play the clip.
Yeah, probably.
All right.
What does a yellow light mean? Slow down. Okay. What does a yellow light mean? Slow down. Okay. What does... yellow light me. Slow down. What
Krusty tells the picture of his dad that he's trying to be an educator just like him. So, like all great teachers, his motivation is money, which is another funny dig at the educational system. He then asks for a sign to see if his deceased father disapproves. But the photo offers nothing, which is the most positive thing that Krusty's father has ever said to him. You know, I'm going to circle back to that point, you know, the motivation is money for teachers. And that's the joke of, you know, teachers should be paid well. But I'll put that into like the WGA strike that's going on. And hopefully it's not going on when this episode drops, but it still will be. You know, when you hear like, was it David Zalazivity or whatever, the guy that owns Discovery?
Yeah.
Is he saying that like, oh, it's not about the money for them. They you know, if they love this job, they'll do it for whatever. It's like, yeah, they have the passion because they love doing that, but it's just not about compensation. And that's the same for like teachers too. It's like,
right.
They have that passion to teach kids. That's why you go in to be a teacher, I'm assuming.
Mm-hmm.
But it's, you're just, at this point, you're just taking advantage of people. And that's what that's what the writers are on strike. That's these big CEOs. They're just taking advantage of these people.
And to put it in perspective, 10 years ago, I don't want to go off on a tangent, but I'm going to. The writers, like 31% of the writers made the bare minimum that you can for being a WGA writer. And now 49% of them make bare minimum. And that bare minimum is like $40,000. And that means that you're living in LA or New York and making $40,000. Like, that barely covers rent here. in Portland, Oregon, let alone in LA.
They have to like work multiple jobs. I mean, you know, a lot of them probably do like DoorDash and stuff like, you know, just to make extra cash. Yeah. You know, that's the problem with rich people is they just prey on the poor. That's and look, again, we're not a political podcast, but this is why finally greatest human being of all time, George Santos, like he got busted because he was stealing rich people's money. Now, if he was stealing poor people's money, he wouldn't have been arrested and indicted or
whatever. That's true. Yeah.
But you fuck with rich people's money, you're going to get fucked over.
Yeah.
Eat the rich, man.
Yeah. No need for billionaires. Back at the Simpsons household, Marge is getting her kids ready for school. Lisa has her multicolored note cards, and Bart has his honk horn for his English class. Lisa wonders why Bart needs a horn, and he replies that he doesn't know, and he doesn't care. And then he rides a unicycle around the kitchen, honking his horn. Homer asks him how many times he's asked him to stop that specific action, and Bart says that, weirdly, it's never come up. So Marge examines the Simpsons house rules and finds that unicycle riding is not in there, but some rules that are include...
No tracking in mud.
No turnip tossing.
Turtle poop dirty.
No ululating, which is a long, wavering, high-pitched vocal sound resembling a howl. Perfect.
Okay. No unhappy pancake faces.
Unicorn poop clean.
Urn ashes stay in urn.
So the good rule. And then in this clip, Lisa expresses her doubts about Bart's new school until he turns her around.
Listen, I don't want to spoil the party.
Yes, you do.
Okay, but I don't enjoy it.
Again, you do.
Okay, but I feel guilty.
No, you don't.
Shut up! Let me speak! Are we sure Bart is going to a real school?
Lisa, don't step on his enthusiasm. This combines a boy's two most natural desires, to be with his family while running away to join the circus.
Lise, for the first time, I feel like you do about school. Can you understand that feeling?
Oh my God, I can.
Cut the treacle. That's what clowns do.
Yeah, I'm really enjoying Lisa just annoyed in this whole episode and Bart calling her out on her.
Yeah.
This is great. It looks like Steve's getting up from his chair. What's he doing? Why are you bending over in my face? What are you doing? Oh, come on, Steve. That's gross. Don't do that.
Gotcha.
Steve, here's my impersonation of our talk earlier. About bidets.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Yeah. The Bart wants what the Bart wants.
Bart wants what the Bart wants. It's true.
Bart arrives at the Herschel Krestovsky School for the Clowning Arts in a very tiny bus with a red nose on the grill. And then dozens of kids get out of the tiny bus, including Milhouse, who's lost his glasses in the kerfuffle. And a clown offers him a new pair of springy eyes popping out, which Nelson thinks Milhouse looks cooler. I think this scene... You obviously knew it was coming, the little school bus, the clown car thing. I thought it was delightful. And I loved Nelson in that scene with him laughing, like doing the ha ha, but then like it turned into actual laughter. It was very good.
I thought it was a lot of fun. The animation of the kids getting out of school was great. And yeah, just really well done.
I'm trying to like look at all the kids that come out, but Milhouse's ex-girlfriend Samantha Stinky, she's too. She's in...
She got out of the Catholic school.
Wow.
Yeah, good for her.
When are they gonna hook up again?
I want to see it.
Okay, that was weird how you put it, but okay.
I mean, I want to see that episode.
Oh.
Not like I want to see them do it.
No. Weirdo.
In History 101, the teacher, along with all the students, are sporting clown makeup. The teacher asks the class, who was the first clown to wear the double-winged neck ruff? Bart is shocked to discover that his hand is erect. and so the teacher calls on Bart, and Bart confidently answers that it was Pickle Herring of Dortmund, Germany, first on the double-winged neck ruff. The teacher then asks who the first female clown was in the U.S., and once again, Bart replies, saying Amelia Butler of the Royal Amphitheater. Bart is striving, and he knows what striving means.
Hey, all this is true. You don't need to look it up.
Yeah, exactly.
We did just to double check, so.
Yeah, good old Pickle Herring.
Yeah. In math class, the teacher shows a demonstration of the parabolic curve by using a catapult to fling a pie into his face. As the teacher lies on the ground in pain, the students all laugh. The teacher wipes the pie off his face and says that the laughter is the best medicine, except for synthetic except for synthetic opiates. Next is music class, where Milhouse, Nelson, and Bart try to play Stars and Stripes Forever on the slide whistle. While Ralph, of course, excels putting the whistle in his nose and expertly performing the entry of the Gladiators before sneezing out his instrument.
I think that Ralph might be a genius, because this is not the first time that he's played a musical instrument in his nose.
Mm-mm.
And he's also a great actor, so I think he was born to perform.
He's definitely going to get an EGOT when he's older.
Oh, for sure. At the dinner table, Homer reaches for the last pork chop, but Bart uses a giant hand grabber to swipe the last piece of meat. Homer reminds his son of the rule that as the head of the household, he always gets the first shower and the last pork chop. Bart then pantomimes being a sad tramp, crying into his hanky, and then squeezing his imaginary tears into his bowler hat. Homer then looks into the hat and is punched by a spring-loaded boxing glove. Homer says, "Why, you little genius?" and then laughs hysterically. Marge is so proud of her son and his ability to deflect his father's rage.
Yeah, I thought this whole scene was pretty well done, too, like directing-wise, animation-wise. Bart's clanling abilities proved everyone wrong in the household.
That's right.
Was that the same way at your household, like when Homer said he's the first to shower? Like, you know, the water heater when I was a kid, like, didn't last that long, so.
Yeah. Dad got shower on Monday. I got shower on Tuesday. And so on and so forth. That's why my parents stopped having kids after 5 kids, because way everybody could have one shower per day or one shower per week.
Right. Well, forgot you had families.
Sometimes I do too.
Like, but in your household, because you were the youngest.
Yeah, no. In all honesty, I was basically an only child.
Right. Because your sister is the closest to your age, right?
Yeah, she's 9 years older than me.
Right. Right. So it's kind of just like you as a baby and your sister and maybe your brother, but then you have no memory really. Or right. You pretty much were.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. They were like just weird young aunts and uncles to me.
Yeah. You were definitely a mistake.
Absolutely. I think about it every day.
You go back in time and give your dad some condoms. The year 1980. Here you go, Dad. Wear these all the time.
Morning, noon, and night.
Yeah.
Maybe you should go to the bar on Valentine's Day of 1981 instead of staying at home.
Well, it's talent night at the clown school, and a banner begs that parents please laugh at other parents' kids. Dieter Wolfcastle plays Yaki Sax on the saxophone, while Bart, dressed as a pilgrim, chases Milhouse, dressed as a turkey, with an axe. Homer is very much impressed.
What is that beautiful instrument?
It's a saxophone.
Why don't you play a fun thing like that?
I play it every night.
Well, why can't you be more yakety?
Mom, tell Dad I'm plenty yakety.
A little more wouldn't hurt.
I don't know, Lisa, like, after going through this so far, I just like how she's just annoyed.
Yeah.
It's a very funny scene. Homer is just
blown away by the yakety sax.
Which I don't know if we're allowed to play that, because it's not free use.
No, that's true.
I was listening to a podcast and they were talking about they wanted to use the yakety sax for something, and it was ridiculously expensive.
Oh, weird.
Like, to put it into a TV show, yeah.
Huh.
I mean, Simpsons got money, so they can afford it.
Yeah, they got Benny Hill money.
Yeah.
Over at the Civic Center, the Science Bowl is taking place, and it's the Red Noses, Bart, Milhouse, and Nelson of Krusty's Clown School, versus the Brown Noses, Lisa, Martin, and Database of Springfield Elementary. And Kent Brockman is the host, asking if the Springfield team is ready. And Martin replies that his mechanical pencil nub is extruded to the ideal length.
Nelson, that's what she said.
Hey, Nelson, presumably with his nub also extruded to the ideal length, punches Martin in the arm. And Martin's actually kind of happy to see his old pal and future lover. I thought that was a sweet moment between them.
Yeah.
The first question is in science, and Team Krusty is happy to answer that the lighter than air gas in question is helium. An hour later, the score is tied at 145 points each. Time for the final question of the event.
Children, remember this inspirational thought. You will have to make up the schoolwork you missed during this time.
Great speech. This is a good time to remind you you're banned from my funeral.
Time for the final question in math. Give the equation for a parabolic curve.
Y equals x squared plus a constant c.
That answer is Correct. This is a Hollywood ending, except Hollywood doesn't write endings anymore. They just tease the sequels.
Krusty?
Sorry, no autographs, selfies, charitable requests, subpoenas, or...
I came to say thank you.
What? Never heard that before.
I hate to say it, but I was almost starting to lose hope in my son. Then you turned him around. God bless you, Krusty.
When the final category is math, Martin opens his shirt up to reveal an equation. Steve, do you know that equation?
I do, but I thought I'd let you tell everybody.
Well, I don't know. That's why I asked you. I'm not that smart.
No, I don't know. I'm not okay. Smart. Did you know things like TGIF in 1993. not like math equations. I can't do anything useful.
I think meant like TGIF menu from 1993.
Yeah. I liked the tater tots.
Do TGIF still exist? I don't think they do. Do they?
I don't think so.
At least not in this area. We used to have them, but they're not.
Yeah.
There's a lot of restaurants we used to have that don't exist. Like, we used to have Fuddruckers, but they're gone.
Mm-hmm.
The only thing we still have left is like Applebee's. Like, but why? Why do we have Applebee's?
Yeah, it's kind of.
It's a bummer.
I mean, yeah. Of that realm of like semi, whatever you call that, you know, like sit down burger place, basically. Is chain Applebee's
like
kind of
the sit down diner chain restaurant evening type of thing? It's like late night.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not your Denny's, but yeah.
Yeah. Kind of like your Chili's.
Your bar and grills. Yeah.
Perfect. Yeah. Your bar and grills. Is Applebee's kind of like the lowest of them, you think?
Look, I have an Applebee's story and it's a little long, but it's the closest bar to my house.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm out for my evening walk and we're like, you know, we're just discussing, Heather and I were discussing, Heather's my roommate slash significant other slash fiance, that, you know, like we don't have like a cool, like Cheers type of bar. And then we end up just like on our evening walk, like screw it, let's go to Applebee's. We'll walk, you know, on our walk, we'll stop in, get a drink or two, and then walk back home. And we end up going there and there's like a group of people just at the bar, but they treat it like, you know, it's their Cheers, you know, like local bar. And I ended up eavesdropping their conversations. They started talking about baseball on TV back when in the 80s and how like on cable it was only TNT and WGN. So they opted to go towards they said he was a Cubs fan because he watched WGN because of Harry Caray. And that's how we were as a family growing up.
Mm-hmm.
And this one lady started talking about her favorite baseball player for the Cubs was Ryan Sandberg. And then I had to interject because that was my favorite as a kid. And
of course.
I tell the story of the time I was in a bathroom and he walked in and took a piss right next to me. So great story, guys. Thanks. So then like the guy says something about like asked if Heather and I like lived in the area. I'm like, yeah, we just out for our evening walk, came in for a drink. He's like, yeah, we should all make this our Cheers. And it was just weird that he like brought up Cheers and on our walk
wow.
too. Yeah, it was like, you know, people say like, oh, you live in a simulation. I really now feel like I am in a simulation and like they're programming. Mm-hmm. Like we get to that bar and like the aliens are programmed. Like, oh shit, we need to program some bar flies. And just only talk about things Craig knows about. Like, it started talking about 80s baseball. And
right. How about that Star Trek, eh?
Yeah, they probably did. They were probably like, I kind of like Phantom Menace. Like, Jesus, I do too.
You know what show doesn't get enough respect? Quantum Leap.
I wish there was a podcast about The Simpsons, but talking about seasons 11 and beyond.
No, a good one, not the 138th podcast.
Yeah. I was like, oh, not in a simulation. Like, yeah, just listen to The Simpsons Show or Four Finger Discount or what are the big Simpsons podcasts out there? Those are the ones, right?
Talking Simpsons.
Talking Simpsons, yeah. But am I going to have to make Applebee's my local bar now? Because like, it's the closest I can walk to it.
Maybe.
Look, they have some cheap drinks sometimes and cheap specials. So I'm not going there for a meal, but just going there, get a draft beer.
Mm-hmm.
It's delightful. They have like a nice horseshoe shaped bar. They don't have as much like tchotchkes on the walls like they used to.
That's good.
Look, am I an Applebee's stands? I'm there for the community. I'm not there for the food. I'm making friends.
Right.
So to answer your question, yeah, Applebee's is the lowest. What would you rather, like if you could walk to, but you're lucky because you literally live right across the street from like 15 bars.
Yeah, that's true.
But like, what would be the ideal bar and grill, like a national chain that you would be like, oh, this is nice?
Good question. It sounds weird, but I kind of would like a Red Lobster.
Whoa, I was just reading your mind because that's exactly what I was thinking too.
Really? Yeah.
If you have the Red Lobster right across the street from you, you know, you still have like the lounge area. I still want the bar.
Right.
Where you can go in, but like the food selection I'd rather have.
Exactly. That's what I was thinking.
It's different because, you know, your Applebee's, your Chili's, your TGI Fridays, your Outbacks, they're all kind of the same. You get a burger, you can get a steak, you know, you get some wings, you know, all the appetizers are all like mozzarella sticks and that kind of bullshit. But with Red Lobster, you know, you got like those fests because you'll see commercials like it's Lobster Fest, which is weird. It should be Lobster Fest all the time because it's Red Lobster. But,
right.
You know, they have like Shrimp Fest, you know, it's like a bucket of shrimp for $5 or whatever it is. Like I kind of would go to that, and I went to a Red Lobster a few years ago out of a whim, and I had a delightful time there. I thought the food was good.
I think they're better than they really need to be.
My only problem was like I wanted to look like a sea shack. Like I want like the ropes and like those little glass like green orbs like hanging
right around. Right
everyone dressed
ship,
like
a ship steering wheel on the wall.
Yeah, I want the windows should be like portholes. I want everyone to dress like the sea captain.
Handsome Pete playing the accordion for a nickel.
Like, I just felt that the decor was a little uninspired.
Sure. Yeah, I get that.
It looked like a hotel lobby or like a hotel, you know, where you get your continental breakfast.
Mm-hmm.
Just didn't look great. But yeah, everything else, the food was actually decent, you know.
Yeah. And, you know, the Cheddar Bay biscuits, they can't be beat. They're delicious.
We'll buy the box and you make it at home. And they're still great from the box, but they're not as good as when you get it at the
Yeah, there's something magic about that.
All right, Steve, I'm proposing to you right now. We have a double date at the Red Lobster. I think Laura would be the only one who's like, why? Like, Heather enjoyed it too.
I would love to do it. I feel like it's going to be a hard sell for one of our partners.
Just you and I have a date then.
Totally. And Heather can come too.
Okay. So the next time we go see a show, we'll go to Red Lobster first.
It's a plan. I like that.
All right. Well, let's get to the Simpsons. Marge is there giving Krusty a big hug, and the other parents praise him. He's then served a subpoena, but he's still happy. He tells the picture of his father that he finally did something they both can be proud of. Krusty's father may have lived to be 97, but he didn't get to see this. Just then, Krusty hears a familiar voice.
Krusty?
Yeah?
Krusty, my boy.
I hear ya.
Krusty, I would like to become a partner in your school, a Carnegie to your Mellon, as it were.
The mob wants in.
Running a school is a dangerous business. I foresee possible boiler explosions, Taco Tuesday trichinosis, a mysterious increase in owies and boo-boos. But I can prevent these things.
Are you threatening me?
Well, since you insist on discussing the elephant in the room, he will be working for me now.
Oh, why does every performing animal turn on me? Are you still mad I separated you from your child?
Did I read somewhere that, like, this woman did something to an elephant, like, killed... I forget what... So this woman did something to an elephant, and the elephant killed her, and then, like, tracked her funeral down just to, like, stomp on the corpse of that lady that did ill will to this elephant. Elephants are very intelligent creatures, by the way.
They are very smart.
I mean, I think everyone knows that.
Yeah.
But don't show an elephant a picture of Mickey Mouse.
Ooh, yeah.
You're scared of the mice.
Mm-hmm.
I thought the segue from, like, Joe Montana, was he almost doing a little bit of...
Jackie Mason
impersonation, like, and slowly... Because at first I'm like, wait, that sounds like Jackie Mason, but he's been dead for a couple of years.
Yeah, it's really true. It was eerie how much he sounded like him.
Like, I wonder if, like, the opening was Jackie, and then they just went right into... But after listening to it now, you know, it's definitely Montana.
Mm-hmm.
But that was good voice acting there from Joe Montana.
Yeah. So our final act begins with Krusty meeting with the mob. He tells them that they already control waste management, casinos, farmers markets, and Girl Scout cookies. Why do they want the school? And Fat Tony explains that their organization has run out of revenue streams. The best drugs are already sold at the nice lady at Walgreens. Gambling is so legally available, it's not fun anymore. Meanwhile, Harvard and Yale jacked up their tuition 10% annually, while they already have $90 billion in the bank. blank. We then cut to Harvard's fundraising facility, which is frantically licking envelopes in front of a pile of nearly $100 billion in cash.
So I'm assuming that this is, like, true.
Yeah.
That, you know, these big Ivy League schools have all of this money. Yeah, this whole part, like, really... I'm so surprised this is all, this whole episode, like, such a political or a statement on billionaires just preying on the weak. Not the weak, but preying on us.
Yeah, exactly. Preying on all of us. Because it is kind of just gross how the educational system in America is just so predatory, both going in and coming out. Like,
look, I took student loans and I regret every second of it.
Yeah. My wife has paid. She stopped paying student loans since then, but she paid for 10 years and she still hasn't, like, broken through the interest yet.
Yeah, it's at the point, you know, just fuck it.
Yeah, it's just awful.
It is. At least they're not going to be talking about healthcare. That's probably next week's episode.
Right, right.
But I also like that earlier Fat Tony's mentioned that the mob owns Girl Scout cookies, which I think that's true.
Yeah.
You can't you can't have that successful business without the mob.
No, it's brilliant.
Why can't the mob take over the Boy Scouts? They have nothing to offer except for stupid popcorn, like beef sticks.
Yeah, and overpriced candy bars that aren't that good.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've seen, because the mob's getting smart, because I've seen, like, people just put QR codes on, like, the side of the road, and you can just order cookies online.
Wow.
And then just pick them up. So they don't even have to, like, wait outside of a grocery store anymore. So it's just brilliant.
Amazing.
So Fat Tony's looking to get out of the loan sharking game and into the far more profitable student loan game. And as he's about to say, it's a better scam.
Education is the last untapped scam left in America. Plus, I've always admired the stone-cold ruthlessness of teachers' unions.
And if that teacher's a nun, you can kiss your knuckles goodbye. Talk about whacking.
Fat Tony, let me be honest with you. I got an agent, a manager, two personal shoppers, and a Shabbos goy. There are no percents left for me to give. And for the first time in my life, as a children's show host, I think I'm actually helping kids.
No, let me be honest with you. We can do this the easy way, or...
You win!
Now, one more thing. Tell me you like me and make me believe it.
I like you, I like you!
No one could fake a kiss that wet.
So that's like, you know, Fat Tony begins, says education's last untapped scam left in America. Is that an oxymoron? Am I using that correctly? Or is that ironic? Or because it is a scam. I mean,
it totally is. Yeah, I think he's just right.
Yeah. Like, everything is a scam, in my opinion.
I mean, yeah, I think these past few years have kind of shown that, like, working in an office is a scam. Paying for college is a scam. Paying your medical bills is kind of a scam. It's all just, like, billionaires getting richer while, you know, us people who aren't billionaires just try to survive and, like, the middle class dies further and further. And, yeah, not the political podcast, but, yeah, the country's in a weird direction, I feel.
I think that majority of jobs out there, anyone can do, except for... like medical professions, because you need to learn about that. I can't just go and perform brain surgery. Writing scripts, you know, for movies and TV, you need to learn about how to do that.
Yeah,
not any schmuck can come off the street to do that. That's why I'm just trying to make sure I'm still supporting the WGA.
Right.
I feel like you and I could be cops.
I mean, God forbid.
We could be airline pilots.
Sure.
Without any education. Yeah.
Yeah.
Lawyers, you just have to bullshit. That's all you have to do.
Yeah.
You don't need to go to law school for that. Yeah. It's all lying. Supreme Court justices. I could take a bribe.
Yeah. I was going to say, like, I could be a politician.
Yeah.
Give me money. I'll keep my mouth shut.
You do not need an education for that.
No, you just need a silk tie.
Just look at our 45th president.
Mm-hmm.
But he did go to the best of schools, though.
Oh, yeah.
He was the greatest student of all students.
Yeah. Nobody better than him at anything.
So what else don't you really need an education for?
What other jobs are there?
There's only doctor, lawyer, writer for Hollywood, president, slash politician, sports person.
I like our only concept of jobs are what's on TV.
Owning a bar.
Yeah.
Raising a family, like on your own with your three, with your two other friends, raising your daughters. That's an easy job.
Sure. Working with your cousin at a newspaper. You don't need to go to school for that.
I'm sorry, WG. I got to take it back. With two of my friends, I could probably write a sketch comedy show.
Sure.
And live in New Rochelle, living very comfortably with my very attractive wife.
Mm-hmm.
We don't sleep in the same bed, but, you know. And my kid, Richie, is fucking annoying. And I have to bring him
upstairs
a present all the time. See what other jobs are there. A witch.
Sure.
And then astronaut. Advertising. Advertising. Yeah. Working in a nuclear power plant, of course.
Mm-hmm. Being a caveman. Working in a quarry.
Just even having a family and being a guy.
Yeah, exactly.
What we're trying to say is just do the job you want to do.
Yeah.
And don't go to school for it.
That's, yeah, basically.
Because school's a scam.
School is a scam.
Now give us money.
Yeah, exactly. I do kind of feel like, I mean, like, if you want to go to college and, like, learn stuff, that's great. I'm all for education. But I just feel like fundamentally, like, I know so few people who got a college degree for the job that they have.
And you're literally talking to one of them right now.
Right. And just so many people. Oh, I got a degree in art or graphic design or this or that, yeah, or writing or journalism. And now I work in a completely different field, which is just, I don't know.
Oh, dentist. You don't need to go to school for that. I know how to brush my teeth. I'll just brush your teeth the way I brush my teeth.
Exactly.
That's all they do, right?
I can drill things.
Look, we're making a joke. Higher education is it's just, you got to pay to learn, I guess. You know, that's yeah, America. That's life. We live in a capitalist society and it's not going to change. So we're not here to change it. We just have to be a servant to the billionaires.
The all IT aller. In a traffic jam at the drop-off lane of the clown school, Luann wonders why the traffic monitors aren't doing the job. Louis explains that Johnny Tightlips is a no-show job, and Louis is a no-work. Tightlips doesn't know why he's there, cruelly stating that he likes Louis' company, but he doesn't love it.
Man, Johnny Tightlips in this episode sure talks a lot.
I was going to say that, too. like Johnny Loose Lips.
So in the classroom, Milhouse learns that all the markers are gone, being sold across the border to Ogdenville without paying the dry erase tax. So at the border of Ogdenville, home of the sign of the same name, very funny, an eager driver pulls up in an unmarked truck, desperately looking for some reds. Louis offers a bag of 5 red markers for 200, and the man looking to buy feels this is unfair, taking advantage of his addiction to highlight important material.
I'm bad at highlighting things. Like, I just highlight everything. I'm just like, oh, it's all important.
I've always been bad at like underlining things or even circling things.
Like, did I mean to cross that out? Or
we're horrible people.
We're not good at things. So this is the thing that we're best at, and we're still pretty bad at it.
Yeah,
we're cromulent. Meanwhile, in the cafeteria, lunch lady Dora is late with her envelope to the mob. She stands there stoically against the mobsters, but falls apart when they threaten her with her own mashed potatoes. Krusty witnesses this and then sees his father's disapproving look. It's time Krusty stops being a terrified clown and starts being a terrified educator. He's going to stand up like a man and rat out the gangsters behind their back. In the shadows of the night, Krusty plays a visit to the Springfield Police Precinct.
Yeah, sorry, Krusty, but the police have no jurisdiction in private schools, private clubs, private homes, basically any place outside the police station.
Are you willing to wear a wire?
I will, but I must warn you, I'm super ticklish.
I'm not even touching you.
But I know you're gonna.
So we figured it's best to put the microphone in the squirting flower.
Gotcha. Does the flower still squirt? Actually, if you squirt it, you'll be immediately electrocuted. Yeah.
Ugh. I would also be that ticklish.
Let's find out. No, we won't find out. I think I would be too. Yeah. But I also like in this scene with Krusty topless here. You know, he's got his scar.
Mm-hmm.
Did you see the third nipple?
Let's see.
Yes, yep, it's there.
Okay, that's good. Yeah.
And his birthmark, that
the bull.
It's just like a line, but it's implied.
Yeah, I think they got it.
It works for me. We won't have to cancel the Korean animators. Fat Tony. Forbid. Yeah. Fat Tony and his gang are playing poker in the cafeteria. Tony announces that he has a full house, and Johnny Tightlip says that he may have the winning hand, but he'll never tell. And then he just sets his cards on fire. So Tony takes the winnings. What if he had like a royal flush? That's probably what he had, right?
Yeah, I think so.
I don't know. He couldn't have because what was Tony's?
He had a full house. It was something over eights, I think. Jacks over eights. So yeah, could have four aces though, or four of a kind.
So three. Yeah, no, he could have a royal flush because he doesn't have a jack of hearts. So tight lips might have royal flush, all hearts. All right. That's probably what it is.
That's true.
Okay.
Probably.
And, you know, you probably don't want to like beat your boss at poker because it'll just whack you off.
No, because that'll. Yeah.
You don't want your boss whack to you. Whack you off.
No, that's one job that he won't give you. Yeah. A hand job.
So as Tony takes his winnings, Krusty steps in, wearing his wired squirting flower. Legs asks Krusty to do the flower bit, and Johnny Tightlips wants to be the foil. But Krusty's stammering, and as the mob grows impatient, Johnny Tightlips demands that one of them get splattered in the next 5 seconds, just as he pulls out his gun. So Chief Wiggum watches through the wire and then shuts his laptop. He's sad to lose another win. It's like he just gives up knowing that Krusty's dead.
Yeah.
This happens all the time. Jesus. He then looks at the memorial wall and all the stars representing witnesses gone too soon. I was hoping that was like going to be a wall of photos and we'd have to like zoom in enhance to see.
I thought about that too. Yeah.
But, like, bummer. It's just stars. Stars. They're just like us.
Dead. So back in the cafeteria, a bead of sweat drops Krusty's brow onto the flower, causing Krusty to be electrocuted. The mobsters all laugh, but Fat Tony knows he's wearing a wire. As Tony's about to get his revenge, the students of the clown school burst in, wearing full makeup, riding unicycles, and honking their horns as they film what's happening.
No one messes with the principal we actually like.
Boss, these kids are making me feel dizzy and guilty.
Silencio! Maybe there is a more civilized solution. After all, we Romans invented civilization.
No, we didn't. We stole it from the Greeks.
Krusty, what if there was a way that I could get my money and you would no longer have me to fear?
I'm listening. Oh, you're burning the school down for the insurance money.
You get an A+ in math.
Aw, I feel bad because Bart was such a good student there, and now it's gone.
And he was happy to defend his principal. It was great.
Yeah.
So a fire truck full of clowns arrive on the scene, blasting a hose on the fire. But instead of water, confetti comes out, just like when Steve has an orgasm.
Uh-huh.
It's causing the flames to grow. But inside the burning school, several tanks of helium explode, and all the students shout, "Oh, no!" in a high-pitched voice. Louis wants to know what to do with leftover gas, and Tony says he can use it in his car. But then Louis states that he drives a Nissan Leaf, which, of course, angers Tony. So Krusty grabs a picture of his father from the rubble and expresses his regret.
Finally did something you could be proud of, and now it's gone.
Not true, man. You made a difference in my life, and that'll never change.
He's right. The boy has learned that if he gives a damn, he will succeed. And that false hope will carry him a long, long way.
Oh, thanks. But I'm afraid I'll need more than that to cheer me up.
Want to get some nachos?
Did you say nachos, the Yiddish word for fatherly pride?
No, I said nachos, the Mexican word for cheese-covered chips.
It's a sign from my father. My father finally has nachos.
I said nachos.
Chipotle on me.
Timing. The most important thing is timing.
There's a weird bit of animation, like the beginning when like Homer just walks in off screen, like he was there doing the wrap up of like, here's what we learned.
Yep. Time for the moral. Got to go over to the fire.
Yeah.
Nachos do sound good, though.
Does the Chipotle make nachos?
I don't think it's on the menu, but I think you can get it. And they do from time to time do have queso. So you could do.
Look, I'm not a Chipotle fan, so.
Me neither. I think it tastes like work.
Yeah. That's another interesting thing about our rant about bar and grills. They gotta have a good nacho.
Yeah, you gotta have a good nacho. It's all about the layering too. You don't want dry chips.
There is a bar and grill in our area on the other side of Portland and Vancouver called Hooligans.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they make the best nacho because there's never a dry chip. You have to try to find a dry chip.
It's impressive.
It's very impressive. And it's layered and it's huge. Like, it's about $15, but they also have like a larger size. But the $15 one, like, two people couldn't finish it. Like, four people, maybe three. But just imagine the larger size. I remember going to their first time and we were like, we're going to order the large nachos. And the bartender's like, no, you're not. You're getting the regular. Like, they didn't even want to upsell us. It's like, you won't be able to finish this one. So they do the nachos right. Probably my favorite nacho.
Wow.
They load it with jalapenos. I love it. Loaded. I hate it when you get nachos and like three jalapenos.
Yeah.
Give me something of a
heat was. I still want my jalapenos.
Right.
It's so tasty.
They put a lot of olives for all you olive lovers out there. I could take or leave it. And you get an option of like pulled pork or seasoned beef or chicken. Got to go with like a pulled pork.
It's the best one. Yeah.
Right. Man, I remember early pandemic, Taco Bell would have this like $14 like giant nacho box. Mm-hmm. We used to get that all the time. It's not the best, but for Taco Bell nachos, it was exactly what you needed. You seasoned all the Taco Bell toppings on like a giant box of nachos. I miss that.
Yeah, it's funny because Taco Bell nachos are their own thing.
Right.
And
they're
every
their
now
own
and
food,
then,
yeah.
Right, exactly. And every now and then I'll get a craving for that specific nacho. And when you get it, it's so good. Nachos.
All right, here's my new proposed YouTube show, because we still have to like look for something to put on YouTube, right?
Right.
We're going to go around the Portland metro area or the Pacific Northwest and find the best bar nacho.
Oh, Bill Oakley.
Are you listening?
You want to come with us?
Yeah. Well, because I still want to do our burger crusade.
Right.
And our nacho
crusade.
Crusade. I can't think of another word for crusade. All right. Does Red Lobster make a nacho?
Ooh. Lobster nachos.
Hey.
It's not a bad idea. Ooh, yeah.
Looks like there's a Red Lobster shrimp nacho.
Okay.
Is that... I just typed in Red Lobster nachos. I don't know if that's on the actual website. There's like copycat recipes for it. So it must have been. I don't know if it's still... Do I have to look at a Red Lobster menu? But I don't really... When I think of nachos, I don't really want seafood on my nachos.
No, you're right.
But shrimp is the most like unoffensive...
I get what you're saying.
Yeah, I don't see any nachos on their app menu. So it must have been a thing they had. They must have like, maybe it's when shrimp season is in session. Look at this. They got a lobster pizza. I want that. Crispy dragon shrimp.
Ooh.
Sweet chili sauce. Look, they got fried green beans. That's good.
Man.
I think we need to have a Red Lobster. This episode is sponsored by Red Lobster. So go to redlobster.com/138Simpsons for a free order of biscuits or some shit like that.
Yeah.
I mean, I know it's probably like frozen and microwave, but...
No, I don't care.
New Cajun Shrimp Trio. What was the thing that I had? It was really good. It was like, I don't remember, but yeah. Anyways, let's do our nacho survey. All right. Let's just wrap up this episode, Steve.
All righty.
The last thing, so we finally got to see who was the clown. The
Debbie Dimples.
Debbie Dimples, Agnes's voice. What if that's actually Agnes? Like, that's her.
Whoa. That's really her. Debbie Dimples?
Yeah. Maybe it's her sister. But yeah, she comes in, does the timing joke. There you go. We do have white credits, so we get post credits. So let's listen to that real quick.
Here are the morning announcements. You children have the greatest gift of all. You cannot be tried as adults. Today is Italian American Day, as is every other day forever. Do not go in the meat locker, no matter what you hear. If you see something, you didn't see nothing.
Good advice.
Yeah.
Every day is Italian American Day. But Fat Tony's probably progressive, so he still won't celebrate Columbus Day.
Right, I think so, yeah.
That would have been funny. It's like every day is, except Columbus Day, we understand. We see the problem with that. That would have been a funny like little post joke. Speaking of post jokes, let's... end this part of the podcast so we could take it to post.
Oh,
to post so they can edit it. And really, I need to go go to clown school real quick and come back. I don't know. Steve, I just want to take a break. Okay,
sounds good.
All right, we'll be right back. And we're back. Steve, let's wrap up this week's episode, Clown v. Board of Education. We're going to talk about things that made us laugh, made us cry, made us ponder. Maybe find a most valuable jokester, MVJ. We'll talk about how we thought about the episode in general, give it a ranking, find out what we're watching next week. But before we do all that, we like to give something from this episode as a gift. Something that we could unwrap on our birthday, on our Christmas day, on our Hanukkah days, on our Kwanzaa days, or just box up on our Boxing Day. Or if you're a mother, just like this episode aired on Mother's Day, if you're a mom, you received this gift, right?
Yeah.
Well, Steve, I got you the gift of laughter and electricity.
Wow.
Yeah, it's a squirting flower that's also a wire. So just take off your shirt and let me attach it to you real quick. Steve,
I can't.
I haven't even touched you. I haven't even touched you yet.
I know, but I knew you would.
So you get a little squirty flower. You know, that's kind of fun. I've never actually seen one of those in the joke store. I kind of want to get one now.
Yeah.
There you go, Steve.
I think about joke stores a lot, mostly because of Pee-wee's Big Adventure.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I just want that place to be a thing. Like, I want to go and have an old shopkeep being like, I got the new trick gum in. Like, it just sounds like a great Saturday. Anyway.
You know what Pee-wee's biggest adventure was, though?
What's that?
Jerking off in the theater.
Yeah. The fun adventure.
I'm coming.
Ah! La la la. Jerking off.
It's gross.
Okay. Yeah. Give me my present.
Due to a documentary that just aired on Netflix, I got an elephant.
And I'm gonna give it to
I got you an elephant, Craig. I know that you always wanted one. You're always saying, where's my elephant? Where's my elephant?
I think that's Bart.
Oh, I always get you too confused. Either way.
I take that as a compliment.
Yeah, I mean, you're an underachiever, and I have to assume that you're proud of it.
I tell you to eat my shorts all the time.
Right. You're always saying, I carumba, cowabunga.
I'm always saying, eat pant.
You're always talking bad about the Iraqi war.
I even have a shirt now that says, I don't even know her own shirt.
If you're a woman and you've got a voice, you've got a personality.
There you go. That's me. I'm Bad Bart.
That's right. So, Bad Bart, I got you a good elephant.
Thanks, I know what I'm having for dinner tonight.
Oh boy.
I'm sure it's tasty. I'm going to make you a piano out of this.
Oh boy.
Yeah.
Do you think 9/11 was worse for elephants because they have such good memories and they could never forget?
I think so. Yeah.
Okay, cool.
All those Manhattan elephants, New York elephants, they're all rich and snobby anyways.
Right. Their trunks up in the air.
Yeah. All right, Steve. What about jokes? Is there a particular joke or visual gag that you thought this was the greatest gag in this episode?
This is kind of dumb, but one joke that made me laugh a lot was in Krusty's commercial for his school. He's making fun of teachers and they're talking about their lesson plan. And one of the guys is like, I plan to lessen the amount of margaritas in this pitcher.
Yep.
This is a great joke. It's also in the background, somebody's just holding a bong. And it's like the fact that the teachers are just lapping it up with their big money and their 9 months of work a year.
Yeah.
I thought there were a lot of good jokes, a lot of like subtle like criticisms of today's society. I really enjoyed Fat Tony talking about all the scams that are happening to all of us. But really, I think I'm going to give my MBJ, it might be obvious, to Bart, because I think especially like at the kitchen table, him as a clown, he was just a good performer. And I really appreciated that. He's naturally funny. And I think that he has funny bones. And so my MBJ is going to be Bart. What about you, Craig?
Yeah, I think my favorite bits were the digs at education. And but definitely that commercial was definitely one of my favorites. I would also give my MBJ maybe to, there's one line that I really liked was Marge. When she's like, there's two things that little boys like, their family and joining a circus. And just her, that's what little kids like, hear about their family the most. It was a very funny life for Marge. But Lisa, I love Lisa's snarkiness episode. So, but you're right, I think for MVJ, most valuable jokester, it'd have to be Bart because he's joking up the storm. But for a most valuable snarker, it's good old Lisa.
Yeah.
So I agree, though, my favorite bit still was that commercial and all the digs at our society. Steve, what did you really think about this episode?
You know, I was pleasantly surprised with this episode because on the surface, it feels like a weird kind of fluffy episode without a lot of poignancy, because it is kind of a collection of set pieces, like going from the academic bowl to like another scene. It's all, they jump around really quickly, and there's not like a lot of big stakes, except for that one steak at the restaurant. But then when you watch it more, you know, you see all like the subtle political comedy and like the criticisms of society, and it's all wrapped up in a fun kind of silly episode. And I think it's really well balanced. It's been a while since we've had like a fun Krusty episode. Like the last one I remember is probably Krusty the Clown from season 30 is like the last most recent one that we've reviewed. But it's funny because it talks a lot about how antiquated the idea of clowning is, and yet it still kind of holds a place in society. And I think as, you know, we're changing what media looks like and what jokes are, I think it's funny that Krusty's still around and maybe not as popular as he once was, but he's kind of still hanging in there, and him having the school and just seeing the kids have so much fun with it. I liked that a lot, and I laughed, and I think this is a fun episode. It feels very like old school, very classic. I'm going to say this was a winner for me. And when they were at the academic bowl, the final score was 146 to 145. So I'm going to give this a solid 127 out of 146.
127 out of 146.
Could I have been nice and smart and give it a 138? Sure. But I didn't.
You gave it a nice 86%, Steve. That's still a very cromulent score.
Yeah. What do you think, Greg?
I think the enthusiasm Bart showed in this episode is great, because he, you know, he found something he likes. So I think that's kind of a fun take, and it's fun seeing Bart excel at something. And yeah, I thought the last couple of weeks were like, oh, there's a lot of social commentary going on in The Simpsons. This is just going to be a goofy episode, but still a lot of social commentary that they brought up, and I thought that was great. And I agree with you. It was a fun episode. And look, I like it.
That's all you got to say.
Yeah, you know, I agree with you 98% of the time. If I had to do a ranking, though, if I were to rank this episode, they when Bart's in clown school, they ask the first female clown, recorded female clown, was Amelia Butler, who was born in 1840. And I thought this was interesting. This is on Clownpedia. So Wikipedia has its own version, Clownpedia. But it says died, 4 question marks. They don't know when she died.
Or if.
So it's very funny that you brought up in this podcast Sarah Sherman, because I've been working on a movie about Amelia Butler.
Oh.
I stopped working on it because of the WGA strike. But
of course.
Here's the gist so far. It's very much like It, the Clown, Pennywise.
Mm-hmm.
But, it's going to be the story of Amelia Butler and portrayed by Sarah Sherman. I've been sending her the script. She'll get it once the strike is over, where she'll be playing a biopic or biopic of Amelia Butler. But also, she's like an alien who doesn't die.
Oh, I like this.
It'll be a fun, it's a fun, you know, comedic, gross comedy. That's what I'm going to call it. The story of Amelia Butler. You know, it's all fictionalized, but it'll be wonderful. I'll send you the script when it's done, of course, after the strike.
After the strike, of course.
Yeah. And then you can contact Sarah Sherman to give it to her.
I will. I'll do that.
Okay, thanks. So what I'm trying to say is that we don't know if she's dead. And if she was born in 1840, and as of this record in 2023, she'd be 183 years old if she's still alive. Ooh. And she probably is. Mm-hmm. So out of 183, I'll give this an episode 138.
Okay.
Which is like a 75. It's a C. 75%. Yeah. Sure. That sounds good. There's that fun photo of Amelia Butler, and it is it's creepy because it's an old photo and they're dressed as a clown. I'm just assuming they're scary. But that's the whole point of this episode, is not the whole point of the episode, but that's kind of the point we were making, is clowning is an art form that's gone away, but with people like Natalie Palladimus and Sarah Sherman that you're talking about, maybe kind of bringing it back. And so Amelia Butler, I think, is an inspiration to these ladies.
I agree.
But you know what I agree on more?
What's that?
Watching next week's episode.
I agree with that too.
Steve, I'm proud to announce, I don't know why I'm saying proud, but next week is the season finale of season 34 of The Simpsons.
Wow.
That's right. Episode 22 of season 34. Steve, what do you think the title is?
Oh boy. So the end of season 34. Wow, it's happened so quickly. The end. New beginnings. And well, this one was called Clown versus Board of Education. So I think they might keep with court cases. So I'm going to say that next week's episode is entitled Moe versus Wade.
That sounds like a fun episode, but it's not. It's actually Homer's Adventures Through the Windshield Glass.
Oh, wow.
What do you think that's about, Steve? It pretty much kind of says right there in the title.
Yeah, I mean, I have to assume that Homer gets in a car crash. And here's my honest guess, and I haven't done any research, but, you know, we're talking about all the political satire that The Simpsons have been doing lately. What if this one is about the medical industrial complex? So Homer gets injured, he has to recover, and then he has to worry about medical bills, and that's the episode.
Well, you got part of it right, because he is in a car crash. This actually sounds like a season finale type of episode. So time stands still after Homer crashes his car and flies through the windshield. As his life flashes before his eyes, a magical friend helps Homer learn the secret truth about his marriage.
Wow.
It's very much what's that stupid movie that we watch at Christmas time?
Gremlins.
The other stupid one.
It's a Wonderful Life.
Yeah, the ass eater extraordinaire himself.
Jimmy Stewart loves the ass.
I love my ass all eaten, even though I don't know how to wipe properly because I don't have a bidet. These are one of my favorite story tropes, so I'm looking forward to this. How about you?
I think it should be a lot of fun.
All right. I think I saw Liz is going to be in it. So.
Oh, boy.
Everyone's favorite new Star Wars character, Lizzo.
Lizzo does sound like a Star Wars name.
She got to pet Baby Yoda.
Wow.
And Jack Black got to play her wife.
That's amazing. I did not know that.
You have no idea. This is one of the new seasons of Mandalorian.
Ah.
Yeah. Star Wars nerds were very hurtful.
I can't imagine that Star Wars fans would react poorly to something.
Right. Well, Steve, I've had fun clowning around with you. We only got one more episode until we are done with season 34.
Boy.
Which means the end of us.
Maybe.
We'll find out next week. Ooh, what a tease. We're just like a Hollywood movie. We don't have an actual conclusion. We just set up the next week's episode or the sequel.
That's right.
All right. Well, listen, if you guys want to contact us, which we really want you to, you can do that on socials like Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube at 138Simpsons.
And you can always email us at 138Simpsons@gmail.com. And hey, if you're so kind, go to your favorite podcatching app and leave us 5 stars or the equivalent. But you don't need to write a real review. Just tell us what your clown name would be.
And hey, we want to hear from you vocally, too. You don't have to just type to us. You can leave us a voicemail. Go to the podcatching app here. Scroll down through the show's notes and it'll say leave a message. You click on the little button and you could just drop us a line. You can also go to anchor.fm/138Simpsons and do it that way.
And, you know, after you're done contacting us, you might realize that you're cold. And then you look down and you're like, oh my gosh, I'm not wearing a t-shirt. Well, we can fix that for you. Just go to tpublic.com/user/annoyedgruntboys and get yourself a shirt. Might I suggest the new, the best, worst shirt ever with the famous line, if you're a woman and you have a voice, you have a personality.
Yes. You could get it on a shirt, get it on a coffee mug. It'll be fantastic. People look at it and like, wow, that's the worst bootleg Bart shirt ever. And that's the point.
What does that mean? Is that offensive? I don't know, is what they'll say.
Wear it to your clown school.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, for this week, I've been Annoyed Grunt Boy Craig.
And I've been Annoyed Grunt Boy Steve.
And remember, I'm plenty yakety.
If you see something, you didn't see nothing.
The most important thing in comedy is...